Jean-Féry Rebel wrote Les Elements in 1736 and 1737. It was the seventh in a series of choreographed symphonies, which he had begun in 1711. The piece was first performed without the chaos section in 1736, apparently for a royal benefit. Then a year later, Rebel added the chaos to it, and it was performed again. The piece was widely regarded at the time as being innovative, daring, and a masterpiece of what was considered to be symphonic literature of the time.
Jean-Féry Rebel was related by marriage to one of the prominent dancers of the day, Françoise Prévot, and earlier he had written Les Caractères de la Danse for her. And if you listen to that piece of music and then you hear this piece of music, it's really that idea probably just blown up and developed, and suddenly we have this little symphony.
Chaos is composed in seven sections, which probably represented to him, as it might to us, the 7 days of creation. The most outstanding part of this chaos is its opening chord, which begins with a dissonance that incorporates all the notes of the D minor scale, sounded at once. And from this kind of opening dissonance throughout each of the chaos sections, Rebel decreases the dissonance and the harsh rhythm and incorporates more and more sweet harmonies, so that by the time he gets to the seventh chaos, everything is peace and light, and the elements all come together.
Dancers did not appear without masks until the end of the 18th century, and it was a little earlier in England, a little earlier in Italy, but France was very strict about wearing these masks. And the idea behind it was that the actors or the dancers were taking on the elements of ancient Greek theater, and they were all masked, and so the French wanted to have their dancers masked and have them to be able to let go of their personal image or their personal selves and take on this character, or take on an element in this case. So each dancer has a costume which is almost like a mask, because it's very much the element, and the mask is then a part of that. And we ask them to let go of their standard ways of moving, their personal ways of moving. So that, for instance, you shouldn't be able to tell that it's Carlos playing fire. He should be doing such a good job that you see it and all you can think of is fire. And the same thing for water and air and amour.
The final caprice is kind of a strange dance written in 9/8. And Catherine said to her it sort of symbolized the idea of all of the elements being created on earth and placed here, portrayed in each of the dances, and then in this somewhat enigmatic caprice at the end of the piece, they go off their own separate ways to form the world.
One has to understand what it means to represent something and then to present that to the audience, as opposed to just being fire. For instance, Diderot talks about being sad, and he says that if you're on stage and you actually cry real tears, that the audience will look at you and they'll see these real tears and they'll think, oh my God, what's wrong with that person? You know, my heart is going out to them. But if you take on, you're representing sadness, where you just have this gesture here and you take your head down, then because it's already removed from reality, it's easier for the audience to read into that sadness and to understand a more universal expression of sadness. I think it's the same experience as when you go to see a puppet show. I mean, you don't get, you know, you don't fall in love with one puppet and then idolize that puppet and you know, make posters of the puppet necessarily, but you go to the puppet show and there's something that's innocent about these puppets, and there's something very direct about the communication that they have when they're performing. And it's that kind of feeling that we want to get with the masked dancers, that there's a purity about it, it is representational art, and that it is something that's removed from our everyday life and that it transcends everyday life to take the audience into another realm.